the approach that I am aspiring to follow myself is the one described in, by Feynman in this excerpt. So he once had a visitor in his office, a historian, and the historian spotted Feynman's notebooks, and he said he was delighted to see the wonderful records of Feynman's thinking. And Feynman protested, "No, no, no! This is not a record. This is actually my thinking. I did the work on the paper." Historian said, "Well, the work was done in your head, and this is just a record of it." "No, it's not a record. Not really. It is working. You have to work on the paper, and this is the paper." So for Feynman, writing is the process that is synonymous with thinking. This is something, this is a sine qua non. You can't have one without the other. So that's one approach. And then there's the nuisance approach. So I already did X. How do I just write it up in the, how do I put it on the paper in the least amount of time possible? And of course, the difference is that the first approach assumes that thinking and writing happen simultaneously, and this assumes that all the thinking is already done, and writing is just the process of converting this into a written text. And here too, I would really love to see where this room falls. Which of these two processes do you follow most in your own work? Please go to Mentimeter and let us know. Okay, well, this is exactly the distribution that I would have expected in this room. If I were to ask in a room of graduate students, I might have seen something different, but I want to do that experiment. Yeah, okay, for myself, it's always 100%. Even if it's an experimental paper, I start writing, I realize that maybe I even need to do some other experiments. And with that, I guess if we're mostly on board with the approach that writing as nuisance is not the most productive, at least for researchers, maybe it's worth considering also the social aspects of this attitude, which I think is exemplified in the very idea of this writing assistance advertised as something that gives you 10x productivity. What kind of writing would people be the most tempted to automate? I would say that these are exercise-like assignments, the school essays, the teaching philosophy statements, diversity training reflections, stuff that we are told to do, and we think that this is just some kind of formality, nobody will bother to read it, and so we will happily delegate it to the chatbot. This is kind of missing the point because, of course, the goal of these exercises is not to increase the number of school essays in the world. It's to help us practice thinking about the concepts that need to be thought about. Not saying that there are not legitimate cases of nuisance, but many are actually necessary. And I would say that propagating the view that writing is mostly nuisance and ChatGPT can help you get rid of all of this useless bureaucracy is a view in which we would see people skip a lot of training that we would ideally like them to receive. One more aspect of writing that I honestly was surprised and terrified to see in the chatbot discussion, but there it is. Writing as human connection. So some people are actively using writing assistants in order to create texts that are deeply personal. So in this case, actually, this user says that, okay, they wanted to basically see this what the structure of the marriage vow was like, and then they modified it to their liking. But there's also this. And I don't know about you, but to me it seems like it's kind of missing the point. There's also this. This university actually had to apologize for mass emailing people GPT written email to express their concerns about a mass shooting event. Again, of course, these emails are expensive to write. This takes effort. This takes empathy. But that's kind of the point of the empathy. It should be expensive. This is how people know that you actually care. There's this. So totally missing the point. And this seems to be getting like really creepy in some cases. I didn't dare to explore more about this product, but apparently it exists, and the people who would use it to automate finding dates also demonstrably exist. So, okay, that was our writing versus thinking role, the roles of writing, and the next point is the attribution problem. And here we can also consider two different ways to write, and one of them, just ripping off of my own process, would be to start from the points or notes that I already have, the things that I strongly internalized. I would try to formulate the question which I'm trying to answer, and then I would try to work towards its solution, bringing in references, trying to find evidence, trying to run experiments, whatever, based on these starting points and question that I formulated myself. And I guess the prime example of that would be the blissful experience of single or lead author writing before you see what your co-authors would like to do with the paper. But okay, let's say that this is the first draft process. And then there's the writing as checking process. And you start from some draft that is already given to you, and you check and tweak and Frankenstein it until it's so coherent. And as an example of that, you could be writing something with a student or co-authors, or starting with a generation draft. In all of these cases, you start with text which already contains the questions, the premises, and everything, all that. So this, of course, assumes that all the creditworthy aspects are sufficiently yours, if you're going to be a co-author on that paper, or are sufficiently attributed. So that's not a problem if you're writing with a student, with a co-author, but if you're writing with a chatbot assistant, then it's less clear. So this is Elicit, a tool that purports to help academics with literature review, and this is how they describe how people use Elicit. So one researcher used a combination of literature review function, rephrase function, and summarization tasks to compile a literature review for publication. I'm mentioning this because many people in this room may be on editorial boards, and papers like this might be already knocking on your door. But basically what this says is that somebody automated a literature review and submitted the version that AI generated for them. And this process, I think, fundamentally brings us to the question of the Socratic student. So the Socratic student, according to Socrates, already knows all the information, and Socrates only helps them to get to it. But then, of course, the teacher in the Socratic method is leading the student very strongly the whole time and providing lots of information. And then the student just says yes and no. So the intellectual input from the student is non-zero, but it would be weird to say that the student is the main, the primary intellectual driver behind the final answer, which the two arrived at. I think it's a good question to ask whether a researcher, by definition, can be primarily a Socratic student. So from the same Elisa
Anna,
tool.
Anna, I'm sorry, oh. can you hear me? It's Melanie,
yeah,
we're
yeah,
almost out of
yeah.
time. Just want to, you know.
Oh, okay. So here's an example from Elisa. They actually say that people use it to find papers to cite. And to me, this just, it's motivated reasoning, right? You don't find papers to cite, you look for evidence to the questions rather than for something to cite to confirm what you already believe. Okay, so apparently we won't have get to do this thought experiment, but as Melanie mentioned before, the cases of legal trouble that are dawning on generative AI, and just like to quickly mention that as well. So something like OpenAI tools, they will say that it's it won't verbatim copy something from the training data, and this tool also claims to do that. Even if they avoid decoding of verbatim excerpts, according to Association of Computational Machinery, if you intentionally paraphrase something to obscure its origin, that is plagiarism. This is what their definition is. So just avoiding direct citations is not enough. And theoretically, this would apply to any non-public sphere in terms of phrases and formatting tips and conceptual contents of facts, something that would deserve credit or attribution in some other sense if it was coming from a human. You may know that Microsoft is already literally being sued for piracy over Copilot. There are artists who filed a class action lawsuit against OpenAI for generative art. Actually, if you read the fine print for ChatGPT, this says that you, by using it, waive your right to the class action and trial by jury. So they try to prevent you from doing that, but courts may actually not let this pass. It's interesting that the legal argument so far seems to be that as long as people can't prove that they used a specific copyrighted work or suffered specific damages from being used in the training data, then they can't sue. And this is the official legal position that Microsoft and OpenAI already put forth. And now it's in the open. Now it's unclear what the courts will have to say about that. But clearly, the power discrepancy is such that they may actually reconsider the whole case. Just so you know, there's inklings of a deliberation of whether to our Section 230, the one that protects platforms from responsibility for user-generated content, actually applies to chatbots. Because once Google or OpenAI says, okay, this is what happened and I published this on my platform, then they become the author, kind of. And now they may be liable. And this is also an interesting conversation to watch. Melanie, do I have time for this?
Maybe about 2 more minutes.
Okay, thank you. One final element of this puzzle is the value of knowledge. And I am not a philosopher in any sense, but if you go to what philosophers say about this, there's a lot of argument about whether what kind of true belief knowledge is. Is it just justified or also undefeated or non-accidental, appropriately caused, produced by intellectual virtue? And a part of, among other things that are under debate, is whether it has to be produced, appropriately caused, produced by a reliable process. Is Hamlet still Hamlet if you get it via the process where 100 monkeys are randomly typing for 1,000 years? There is a philosophical position that yes, it is still Hamlet. It's as good as Hamlet from Shakespeare. A cup of coffee from an unreliable machine is as good as a cup of coffee from a reliable coffee machine. But I think apart from this philosophical question, we need to consider that we don't actually just consider the Hamlet or the cup of coffee in the vacuum. Right now, we are at the point where chatbots and writing assistants are an emerging cultural technology, which is actively shaping our landscape, and we need to come up with responses to it as a society. And the reliability of these tools definitely matters to us as NLP developers. It matters to us as researchers, because we have to solve this attribution problem. And it matters to the general public, because we might right now be teaching the whole population of the globe that there's this nice entity who understands you and knows everything about you, who will tell you everything you want to know, 100% no issues at all. So, and I guess I will have to skip this part. No, I can't just let this go. So,
so just to wrap, we need you to wrap up, unfortunately, but maybe just one more minute.
Okay, well, let's just wrap up.
All right. Thank you.
Anna, it was really nice to have to get to hear you twice.
Thank you.
I have a question. Watching all the banality that can be spewed out by these large language models, I wonder, you had one point where you said thinking versus writing. I wonder if what this will be a filter so that only writing that actually does show evidence for thought will survive. And everything else we can actually forego. I mean, we know that most of what you read and write is rubbish, right? So we'll end up with just good things, right? I mean, obviously, and we should be happy about that.
This is a wonderful point, and I've been trying to think about this. And it seems to me that already before ChatGPT, we had way too much content that was produced that we could ever possibly have time for, right? Even with research papers, we can't possibly keep up with everything that was produced pre-ChatGPT. And I think if we are inundated with written information that with 10 times the volume, well, that's not going to happen, right? That's not possible. So I guess as coping strategists, we will all come up with some filters about things that we will and will not decide to spend time on. And we will seek channels, filters, which will narrow things down to not let the generated crap get to us. I don't know what those filters would be like, but it's clear to me that the people in this room already have such a filter in themselves and they're desperate that they have. So I guess that would be what you guys would use, but I don't know what will happen to people who are not already supported by a strong network which could act as such a filter.
Great. Jeremy.
So in part, this is a question of how the availability of a certain technology bears on how we assess students and their performance. So there's an older instance of this in math education, the availability of calculators, and this ongoing debate, should students be able to use calculators and should they be able to use computers? So I'm just wondering, nothing's been resolved there, but it's older. It's been, it's a debate that's been around longer. So I'm wondering if there's anything we can learn from that discussion.
Right. Well, I guess there's a kind of convergence on the point that, okay, nobody needs to, not everybody needs to learn how to do integrals by hand, but everybody does need to know the basic minimum to survive in a supermarket, right? I guess that's what the schools try to get done. So then if this parallel holds, then the question to us is then, okay, what's the bare minimum of thinking that we think that students should be able to perform without ChatGPT?
DA.
Thanks. On the plagiarism topic. I wonder if you have thoughts on how we could develop a taxonomy of style. It strikes me that there's a difference between me saying I want to write in the style of Bernard Williams and the algorithm copying the diction or syntax of his writing versus wanting to emulate sort of some deeper logical signatures of somebody else's thought or work. And so it strikes me that a sort of catch-all like style is inadequate to distinguish between the different ways in which you could copy someone's approach.
Absolutely. I wish, NLP community is not using the term style very consistently. It's not even, so I guess the generative art has already started the discussion about whether it should be even allowable to just say, generate me something in the style of this known and living artist. based on their existing and not public public domain data. So in addition to what the model learn and what the model can transfer and what the model should be allowed to transfer, there's the question what we're even aiming for here. Like should anybody be able to just say, okay, I want to impress my girlfriend, generate me a love letter of whoever is the most famous artist in that genre? Should that be something that goes without attribution to that somebody?
One more question, Chris Moore.
So yesterday when we were talking about mathematics, John tried to successfully, I think, extend the conversation to other areas of human creativity. And, you know, your question about is writing part of the thinking process and the, you know, not just the checking the logic process, but finding new connections and so on. And I think certainly artists and other creative people in nearly every field would say that trying to have their ideas actually work in the medium that they're working in is a profound part of constructing the ideas themselves, right? I mean, I think those of us who like music have always woken from dreams in which we thought we had a great idea for a symphony or something. And then, you know, well, you learn that maybe you didn't actually, although maybe now you could just say to you could just hum a few bars to ChatGPT and then it could, you know, expand it out. So I guess I'm wondering about the loss of that feedback process that, you know, if it becomes too easy to take something kind of very vague and crummy and turn into something that sounds good, that has all the statistical patterns of something which is thoughtful, and maybe also read aloud in a rich baritone authoritative voice, you know, that, well, I'm worried about that. That we'll be doing a lot of crummy thinking, which we won't even know that our own thinking, let alone others, is actually pretty crummy.
Absolutely. I guess to me, the first signal of that was that I noticed that people were, let's say, more likely to be impressed by ChatGPT if they weren't very good or enthusiastic about writing themselves. So for people to whom it's a nuisance, that's a godsend, of course, but you can't automate you can't pay somebody to go to a gym for you, and you can't automate thinking if the goal is to have your own thinking out of the world, out in the world. So I don't know how that's even possible.
Let's thank Anna again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And now we'll hear from the respondent, Tom Mitchell, who is Founders University Professor at Carnegie Mellon and also on the SFI Science Board.
Okay. Anna, thanks for that talk. I had a couple comments, and Anna, this is bad positioning. I can't see if you're still with us. Anna, are you there?
Yes, I am. Yes.
Okay, great. Okay, because I had a couple of comments. I was hoping we could get your reaction to some of them. Oh, no. Okay. I just failed as a computer scientist to pull up the conversation I was having with GPT-4 during your talk. And I accidentally deleted it. But I will summarize it. It remembers. Oh, that's right. Okay, you know, give me 30 seconds to see, because it does remember. Or you may see me fail twice. Really bad. It's all a question of... Oh, I see, I've lost my internet connection. Okay, I'm very sorry about this, but I can truthfully present what the conversation went. So Annie, you started your talk by pointing out that as the co-chair of ACL this year, you had to face this question of what would be an appropriate policy? Should we do anything about this? So I did ask GPT-4, what would be an appropriate policy for a research conference in which authors might be using GPT-4, should there be a policy? And it recommended a policy, actually a very thorough, long-winded policy, which I realized I wouldn't have time to read to you all. And so then I asked it, please rewrite that policy using half the number of words, which it did very well. And it recommended, and I won't be able to recall all of these points, but it had 5 points in the policy. One was that authors should report the use of GPT if they use it. Second is that they should be aware of the potential of misstatements, and therefore they should be, they had a responsibility to verify and check the content. The third point, which was my favorite, was they should consider listing GPT as a co-author. And they had a couple other about DEI and things like that. So then I said to it, well, it's kind of unusual to list computer programs as co-authors. Could you list the arguments for and against this? And it said, yes, this is a debatable point. And it listed arguments for and against, which were not half as interesting as the mere fact that it did suggest that it could be a co-author. The arguments it gave for example, were that it is traditional that it did not use the word agents, but it did mention that it is traditional to include as co-authors all of the contributors to the content of the paper, and this would be a just thing to do. It also listed as an argument in favor that this will help speed the collaboration of humans. It'll help, it's a kind of transparency that will help both reveal and speed the collaboration of humans and computers. It gave a couple arguments against. They had to do with tradition and this being kind of a game changer. So anyway, I'm really sorry that I stupidly deleted the page that was on my iPad here. But you get the conversation and you get the points. I'm just curious your thoughts about that.
Yeah, this is an interesting experiment because So I asked ChatGPT a lot about whether its content is original and does it have creativity and such, and whether it should what about the attribution to all the people with the training data on which it was trained. So what came back seemed to be scripted responses in line with the general OpenAI policy about how this is both simultaneously original and not original and completely reliant on training data, but also somehow original and creative based on that. I think it has a lot of scripted text and it tries to walk the rope around, and the fact that it's if it is now part of that scripted suggestions that it should be listed as a co-author, it would be an interesting move on OpenAI side.
Okay, well, so whatever that earlier conversation that David and Melanie were having about agency, it's presenting itself as a viable co-author. So that's kind of interesting. Second thought I had in response to your talk, you forced us, or you recommended, and we all happily obliged, to say whether we thought that writing was actually part of the research, part of the thinking that we were doing. And an overwhelming number of us said, yeah, of course, that's, writing is part of thinking. And to me, this also raised the question of to what degree is that true of GPT? That is, when you ask it a question, does it think of the answer and write? Or does it start writing and generate the answer? I used to have this naive view of myself that I would think of something and then I would speak, but friends have pointed out that that's not always the case. And more and more, I believe, well, let me just point out, many of you are probably aware that there were a couple of papers published about a year ago or two now about chain of thought prompting, where people showed that they could get more accurate answers from earlier versions of GPT and other language models if they, instead of just asking the question outright, asked the question and said, let's think about this step by step. And that would prompt GPT to not just give the answer 42, but to lay out the chain of reasoning that got to that answer. That is now part of the conventional wisdom of how these systems work. And as somebody who's given GPT a lot of simple math word problems and more complicated ones, it does seem to me that if you give me a problem, like I bought a crate of eggs that contained 18 cartons each with a dozen eggs, and one carton broke, how many good eggs do I have? I'm going to say, well, let's see, you had 18 cartons times 12. I'm not yet thinking about the fact that one broke, right? I'm thinking how many you had. I'm kind of speaking as I'm thinking. And to some degree, one of the big impacts that chain of thought prompting and large language models have had on my own thinking about the process of reasoning is it makes me much more open to the idea that producing language is tightly coupled with producing answers and the reasoning process itself. So I just raised this as something for us all to consider. I don't know, Anna, if you wanted to respond to that or not.
So with respect to whether ChatGPT itself uses writing in order to think better,
Well, whether it knows the answer to begin with, or whether it actually is a process of writing.
It doesn't know anything, right? It's trying to generate the most plausible outcome. And I'm entirely on board with the idea that you are more likely to get the correct answer by trying to generate through these intermediate steps. Now, another interesting thing you said was that we, as humans, may also not think enough before we say or speak or say, before we say or write or do anything. And this is entirely true, but I guess the kind of writing that we were talking about in the Mentimeter and what Feynman was talking about is, well, the best thinking that we are capable of, the ones that we would like to get the Nobel Prize for, right? and this is, of course, we are not able to be at that level 100% of the time, but I guess the overall idea is to try to be as close to that as long as possible as researchers.
Okay, thanks. So I thought I would, especially since this is the final half day of our meeting, take the opportunity of being up here to also kind of look a little bit more broadly at the conversation that we've been having the last day and a half. And there are a couple, I mean, very much embedded in the conversation that we've been having are a couple questions about where's this heading? How is it going to change our notion of what knowledge is, of what books are, of what how we represent knowledge, how that's just our whole philosophy of thinking about that. And so I wanted to suggest a couple conjectures about where this is going. And so here they are. First, we are going to see, as several people have pointed out, more sophisticated versions of these models trained, for example, on multimodal data, trained on all of YouTube, for example. And so that will address some of the issues that I think Melanie was bringing up earlier this morning about what can you get from text alone. It'll still leave proprioception and some other things out of the equation, but that, of course, is going to happen. Many of my friends tell me we're going to see a flurry of specialist versions of large language models, one for the law, one for medicine, so forth. But I'm curious about that because another conjecture that I'd like to put out there is that maybe we have just seen a sea change in AI, where the conventional wisdom we used to believe, which is if you want to build a great AI doctor assistant, you should sit down and get all the medical knowledge you can and put that into a system. Or same for a lawyer. But we've just seen that GPT, which is trained on everything, passes the LSATs, the legal exam, at a really high 99th percentile, something like that, level compared to humans who take that exam. So GPT achieves high competence in the legal domain and in several other domains by being trained to do everything as opposed to being trained to do just one thing. And of course, we could give it even more text to read if we wanted to make it an even better doctor. We could give it more textbooks to read about medicine. But the question I would put forth is, which will work better, getting exclusively medical text and training a model, or training GPT to do everything and then giving it some more medical text? I think the evidence is kind of leaning toward the second right now. That's a sea change for AI, if it's true. Another thing that I think we're going to see is having a conversation right now with GPT is like Well, you're having a conversation with a stranger. It doesn't know you. It's a stranger. It's kind of a weird stranger. It's a very well-read stranger. It's a very overconfident stranger. It's a kind of strangely apologetic stranger, if you point out the mistake that it makes. But it's a stranger. It doesn't know you. The best conversations, the most efficient, the most productive conversations you can have are often with people who do know you. And that's coming, I think, very quickly. It's not coming because we have the resources to train 7 billion instantiations of GPT, but we don't need to, because there are two ways. This is another game changer for AI. There are two ways for AI systems, for GPT and similar systems to be told things. One is to train it and adjust the parameters, those 100 billion parameters that are tuned during the months and months of training gradient descent that it takes. So one way to give it knowledge is to train those parameters. The second way is it to give it text to read as background. With the current version of GPT-4, you can now give it roughly a 100-page book as the prompt, as part of the prompt. So we will soon have, I think, individual versions of these models that are actually the same, have the same parameters. We're not going to retrain them for each of us, but they'll have a different book to read about our biography before they answer our question, or before we give the question. Part of our prompt will be, here's my bio, now let's discuss whatever you want to discuss. So think about that. Think about how we will achieve that, what your bio should look like if you want to communicate it to GPT, so that it can, for example, know better that you are a specialist in medicine, or you do understand computer science, or you don't, or you know nothing about canoeing, and you're just thinking about doing it on your vacation. So I think that's another direction that's going to be very interesting. And it's very feasible, since we can simply give our bios as part of the prompt. Next to final thing I'll bring up, is that fair? Is teams. So many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with Hariri's great book, Sapiens, which, whose main point was, we're not so smart individually, after all. We're not that much smarter than humans were 20,000 years ago. Evolution hasn't had that much time. But we're incredibly effective because we don't operate as individuals, we operate as teams. It's the social structure, the whole structure of the world that we've now assembled that lets us get things done as teams. Right now, GPT is an individual, but that's already changing. There are already things like auto GPT, bad name, up on GitHub, which is, which is software that will let you spawn multiple instances of GPT agents and have them work as a team to solve your problems. And there's a very rich area for research. But again, if you think about what we know about individual intelligence versus team intelligence, it can't be very far in the future that we start seeing a lot of experimentation with teams of these large language model agents. And the final thing I'll just leave you with, been thinking a lot of people, talking with a lot of people about how GPT changes our notion of libraries and books. And you know, the whole history of writing, there have been these revolution after revolution. Writing itself was a revolution, because before writing, we had to be in the same room at the same time to exchange ideas. Now you can just write it down and leave it there. I don't have to be temporally co-located or spatially co-located. Then we got printing presses. That was a big deal because a lot of people could read it. Then we got the internet, which was a big deal because a lot of people then had access to a printing press, a virtual printing press. Anybody could write and show the world. This is, I think, an equal revolution because the effect of GPT on books, I think, is it's going to make every book into no longer a monologue. A book is a monologue, right? You write it, there's no conversation there, there's no interlocutor there to probe you as you're writing the book. It's a monologue. You leave it behind, somebody picks it up and reads it. This will change books into conversations. I can give GPT the book and have a conversation with GPT if I don't have time to read the whole 100 pages. And when we have personally knowledgeable versions of GPT, it'll already know that I know the basic algorithms of machine learning, but I don't know this particular content. So it'll know what to talk about. So, and furthermore, think about this one. The author of those books, in addition to producing the text of the book, are going to want to make sure GPT has the right kind of conversation about their book. And so the next textbook that you write, you should think about people are going to put that book into GPT to have a conversation. As the author, you also get to give instructions as part of that prompt to GPT about how to think about the book itself and what are the highlights. So I'll stop there. My time is up. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. I know that's really provocative. So, but I'm going to just stay a few. Why don't you stay up here, Tom, because there's going to be some questions for both you and Anna. A little interesting anecdote about all this. So there was a paper that was published about a couple months ago called by Microsoft research folks called Sparks of AGI. It was published on a preprint server called the Archive. And interestingly, usually you will go there and you'll click on the PDF to get the paper, but they also, Archive requires you to put the original LaTeX source, that's a text formatting language, where most people don't, that the authors assume you won't look at that. But if you look at it, you can see things that they commented out in the text. And two interesting things that they commented out. One was the title, Sparks of AGI. Yeah. There was actually a commented out title, which was First Encounter with an AGI. And there was another commented out author, GPT-4, affiliation OpenAI. And I asked the first author of the paper, like, why didn't you use that? And he said it was for PR reasons. Anyway, just interesting. So open to questions for Tom or Anna. So Allison.
Thanks so much. I have so many questions, but I won't stack them. I'll just ask one. It just starts with a story, which is I'm receiving all the time emails from women pointing out all these instances of bias, gender bias in GPT, ChatGPT. And the interesting thing I found is that when you go into GPT-4, it has corrected all of them. I don't understand how that works. So I'm wondering if someone could give me a technical explanation of how this human feedback, reinforcement learning, human feedback system works, or do we not know how they're making these corrections? I don't understand it technically. So
I do not know what they're doing. I do know that. Well, go ahead, Melanie.
I was going to say that it's not true that they've excised all the gender bias from GPT-4.
Well, the ones I've checked, but you know what else? Melanie, I forgot to tell you. I put into GPT-4 the question about SFI with the same prompt. It had fixed it. I can read it to you if you like, but that'll take up too much time. So I'm fascinated by how they're doing that. And maybe that's the reason Sam Altman is saying that you know, we've reached the limit of increasing these model, you know, just making them larger and larger. It's going to be new innovations that take us to the next level.
Well, it is true that ChatGPT and GPT-4, I guess, were trained in a slightly different way, augmented way compared to, say, GPT-3. It is true that the original ones were trained just to predict the next word, but these newer models were trained first that way, so they could predict the next word. But then after that, they were trained with a reinforcement learning system on top of that first model. And that reinforcement learning system used human labeled data about, you know, given this question, which of these two responses is better? And using that kind of data, is different. So all the things that many times in the last few days we were mentioning, oh, but it's only trained to predict the next word. That's true in the first phase of training, and afterwards there's something else going on. They haven't been very forthcoming about the details of that.
James. Sorry, Anna.
So it is true that they keep patching a lot of examples of bias and things that hurt their reputation, which keep being reported online. But it is definitely not true that they use gender bias. There's a never-ending game of whack-a-mole that's going on, and they collect a lot of adversarial instances. But I think the main thing that this achieves is that it makes it harder for us to see that there still is a problem, whereas the underlying distribution didn't change, and hence the model will probably behave inappropriately in a situation where gender bias may be exhibited, for example, in classification or text generation or something.
Go ahead, James.
Thanks. Yeah. So, Tom, you talk about its improvement in the context of step-by-step learning, and there's many contexts in which it gives the wrong answer, and then you ask it to reason about the answer, and it comes to the right answer, a different answer. But this also suggests the capacity for the model to reason with itself. For example, you're talking about its enhanced ability to facilitate human-machine interaction. So how do we think about GPT-A and GPT-B interaction? How do we think about the fact that it can kind of collaboratively ratchet itself through conversations to insight? One example that I've been playing with is I've generated millions of abstracts that combine concept X and concept Y with a novel hypothesis linking the two together. These are things that don't exist in the world. And then I ask, GPT to reflect on and improve that hypothesis, and through a series of interactions, it produces things that experts in X or Y find genuinely novel and have no existential sampling from the distribution of claims, for example, in the literature. So how do we think about the future of machine-machine interaction and how we interact with that?
Great question. One of the things that people have been doing is you can ask GPT to respond with different personas, right? So respond in the style of Hemingway or respond in the style of Shakespeare. I don't know how successful it would be, but it might be interesting to create personas of different scientists with different conjectures, and then, create a team of these things that really come at the scientific question from different perspectives with different conjectures and let that play out. I think that's the kind of thing you're getting at.
Thank you. Yeah, David mentioned also, this possibility of kind of channeling different logics.
Yeah. We have time for just one more question, Chris Moore. Oh, okay, Abba.
Shout.
Can you hear me now? Yes. All right. Stories are often the way that we look at the world and we make sense of the world. Let me tell you my story. Let me tell you your story. Let me tell you our story, right? So if ChatGPT is starting to write in the styles of the different authors that have already lived, the authors actually had an intention, right? They created a certain structure, a certain way of telling a particular story because it fit into the purpose that they were trying to demonstrate. But now I feel like you can ask ChatGPT, right? Say a story in the style of Gabriel Garcia Marquez, for example, or Orwell, or even Taslima Nasreen. But the problem is because it is now building new stories based on what already existed, right? It is creating stories for us that are not necessarily, like Melanie said, a consequence of our own embedding in the world as it is. So if these kinds of literature start cropping up and eventually start getting published and being fed into our own consciousness, will that, I mean, it will obviously change our sense of self, but I just wanted to check if, you know, what the discourse was there among the computer scientists, especially.
Go ahead, Anna. I wish computer scientists had more of that discourse, at least in NLP. Like I mentioned, generally the discussion of style is rather impoverished and not what it should be. But I think the debate about let's generate something in the style of X that I've seen so far, they kind of assume that yes, this is an entirely transferable property that you can throw onto everything, and it should work with anything. Like it should be possible to write a nursery rhyme in the style of Dostoevsky, which is really not what it was meant for. I wish there would be more discussion about what contexts, different genres, different personas can even exist and live in, because that's not at all so transferable and universal. I don't have much more.